Let's pray, and then you will, we'll jump into the scriptures in Luke chapter 21. Our Father, you are so good, and we're grateful for the fact that you lead us through times of plenty, and times of blessing, and times of abundance, but you also lead us through those times when it feels like the world is closing in, and where it feels like everything's crumbling around us, and there's no sure footing. And thank you, Jesus, that when we feel like things are entirely liquid and we don't know what we can cling to, thank you, Jesus, we can cling to you. And thank you that we can cling to your promises. That even when we don't necessarily, we're not able to see you clearly even at times, we can know that you are present and that you are faithful. And so, Jesus, I pray for individuals here that are wrestling in that place of anxiety. Lord, I pray for this whole congregation, Father, that there just be this great sense of peace, this great sense that we can trust you, that you are on the throne, that you have not vacated that seat, and that you will continue to take us one step at a time in the direction that you are calling us to go. And so, Lord, when things start to get crazy and chaotic, Lord, may we continue to come back to remember you are faithful, you are God who provides, and you are God who is present with us. Thank you, Jesus. Speak to us now, we pray, in your name. Amen. Well, Luke chapter 21, when anxious times come, we want to follow Jesus' practices. Luke chapter 21, it begins with Jesus pointing to his disciples and showing this woman who is giving a little bit that she has into the temple treasury. And he is just talking about how wonderful it is to see this woman of faith who is giving, though it seems as though a little, she's actually giving a tremendous amount. And wouldn't you think the disciples' natural inclination would be to say, isn't that amazing that woman has given all she has, the little tiny bit that she has, and she's trusting God. And that's wonderful, and we should trust him too. Instead, they turned their eyes to the temple building. Verse 5, some of his disciples were remarking about how the temple was adorned with beautiful stones and with gifts dedicated to God. Wait a minute, do you catch that scene? Jesus trying to draw his disciples, well, what's really important here? And they're in awe of this magnificent structure. And it would have been a magnificent structure when it was rebuilt after the Old Testament days when it was destroyed and when the Israelites were taken away to Babylon and then they returned, it was rebuilt. And then Herod comes along and he begins this whole another building project onto that current temple. So he's basically doubling the size of it. He's making it this incredible structure that so people walk by and say, wow, look at this amazing temple that the Jewish people have, that Herod is investing so much time and energy of his own and getting good work done on that. And Jesus' disciples are caught up in that. Jesus says this, as for what you see here, the time will come when not one stone will be left on another. Every one of them will be torn down. Now, if you're not familiar with Jewish history, let's just take a bit of a pause here, because some of us, we like to read through this text, and as we'll read through, some of us like to jump immediately to what is to come, and we like to look at this text and really read books that indicate, oh, this is going on in the Middle East, and this is going on in our day and age, and it's wonderful. There's nothing wrong with that. However, let's just make sure, first of all, we anchor ourselves in the original context of what was actually Jesus speaking to first and foremost, okay? Because this was highly relevant to the people. When he's speaking, this is about 30 AD. Within 30 years, in the year 66 AD, remember, Rome is the power at the time. Rome is the ones who have control of Jerusalem and the whole region there. In 66 AD, the Jewish people revolt, and the zealots get control of the city and basically kill the Roman soldiers, and they now have a fortified city that they are defending in 66 AD. By 70 AD, Rome brings their soldiers, and they march on Jerusalem, and they lay siege to the city, and there's all kinds of crazy stuff. You can go on Google this, you can find some Wikipedia, wherever you want. You'll find that actually the people starved in Jerusalem. The armies came rushing in, and ultimately everything was basically destroyed, including the temple, which was burned down. So what Jesus is talking about here is fulfilled within 30-ish years, and all of this crazy stuff that he's talking about was actually tangibly right in front of the people within 30 years. Okay? So that is to say, a lot of this was actually happening right when Jesus was speaking, or within years of Jesus speaking.
It's also to see that this is the kind of stuff Jesus also says, beware, because this stuff is to come over the years, right? And as the time of Christ's return approaches, this stuff will happen all the more. We're going to hear wars and revolutions and people who are claiming to be the Christ, and we're going to see earthquakes and famines and all of that stuff, right? So that's that stuff's really important. However, it's also important that we look at the first century, what was actually happening here. Now let's go on, we'll read, because what is this? What kind of relevance does this have to us? It has relevance in the sense of the macro sense, right? We need to be alert and aware, and we need to make sure that we're ready for Jesus' coming. However, it also speaks to us at the level of the micro kind of, in a day-to-day interaction, there are going to be situations that we encounter that raise the level of anxiety, which is happening here, right? Jesus says, hey, whoa. This stuff's going to happen. There's going to be crazy stuff that happens. And he's going to go into detail. But when that happens, I want you to remember some things. And this is what we're going to look at in this message. Verse 7, the teacher, they ask, when will these things happen? And what will be the sign that they are about to take place? And he replied, watch out that you are not deceived. For many will come in my name, claiming, I am he, and the time is near. Do not follow them. When you hear of wars and revolutions, do not be frightened. These things must happen first, but the end will not come right away. Then he said to them, nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes and famines and pestilences in various places, and fearful events and great signs from heaven. We see some of this happening even at the cross, right? There's an earthquake. There's darkness that covered the whole earth. We think about a reference back to the book of Exodus, where God brought these plagues in, right? God does this in certain seasons, in certain times throughout history. But before all this, verse 12, they will lay hands on you and persecute you. They will deliver you to synagogues. And synagogues, the Jewish people have their own system of discipline. And so there was discipline that would happen in the synagogue, saying you'll be turned over to synagogue and prisons, and you'll be brought before kings and governors, and all on account of my name. Let's skip on down to verse 16. You will be betrayed even by parents and brothers and relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. All men will hate you because of me. Let's skip on. And I'm skipping these verses. We're going to come back to them. Let's skip on to verse 20. When you see Jerusalem being surrounded by armies, then you will know that its desolation is near. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let those in the city get out, and let those in the country not enter the city. For this is the time of punishment in fulfillment of all that has been written. How dreadful it will be in those days for pregnant women and nursing mothers. There will be great distress in the land and wrath against this people, and they will fall by the sword and will be taken as prisoners to all the nations. Jerusalem will be trampled by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled. There will be signs in the sun and moon and stars on earth. Nations will be in anguish and perplexity at the roaring and the tossing of the sea. Men will faint from terror, apprehensive of what is coming on the world, for all the heavenly bodies will be shaken. Let me pause there. Jesus is saying, you can rest assured this thing. You can rest assured that your life is going to be stabilized. Now, there's an ultimate destabilization that Jesus is referencing here that happened around the time of Jesus' crucifixion and his resurrection, and will happen again when Jesus comes to make all things right. But you can also know that your life will be destabilized. You will find situations where you come along and you come into work one day and you find you no longer have a job. You may go to a physician for a regular checkup and you find that actually you've been diagnosed with something that you didn't expect. You're going to find that there's going to be something happens to your children or your teenagers or your aging parents that you didn't expect. Something's going to happen in the financial markets that all of a sudden you made one wrong move and everything. It's like the carpet's pulled out from under you. You can expect times of instability will come. That's a guarantee. Jesus says, that's a guarantee. Here's the question. See, for the disciples who said, look at this beautiful temple. How beautiful this wonderful, luxurious temple is. And we worship here. And our God dwells here, right? Only to find Jesus saying, this temple's going to fall down. It's going to crumble beneath you. Don't fix your eyes on the temple. Here's the question for you and I. What's your temple? What's your Jerusalem? What's the thing you point to and you're proud of? What's the thing that you find security and assurance in? Where do you find that sense of
ah, this gives me a sense of protection and peace. That's what the temple was to the Jewish people. That's what the temple was to the disciples. And what is it that if it was pulled out, pulled away from you, or you found, you woke up one day and it was no longer there, what would that thing be? You can rest assured that destabilization will happen at different moments of your life. There's an ultimate destabilization of the whole world, but there's individuals have these moments of destabilization. Are you in one of those right now? Do you know what that's like? Have you sensed that? Have you felt that? When that happens, you can rest assured that this next thing, to watch this. When you are attached to something and it becomes destabilized, I can guarantee you, you will be afraid and you will become vulnerable to deception. Okay? When you, if you're clinging tightly to a Jerusalem, to a temple, whatever that may be to you, and that is removed, your automatic thing will be, uh-oh, I am absolutely terrified, now what? And you will be vulnerable to deception because the natural impulse is like, I gotta find something else to grab onto, right? And that something else could actually be something that is deceptive, something that is false, something that is not true. When we become highly vulnerable because the carpet has been pulled out from under us, because we are in a place of destabilization, we are naturally open to deception and fear. It's like when your car, and forgive me for using a snow illustration, but when your car hits a patch of ice, you're driving, it hit a patch of ice, and you lose control, right? You no longer have control, and you're used to having control when you're driving. You know how that feels? That's what it's like. And Jesus wants to remind his people, not only here, but he wants to remind each of us, if your stability comes from a temple, from Jerusalem, from whatever it is that you're grabbing onto, and you're saying, I'm so thankful I've got that, because that's what brings me peace and security and stability. And if that was taken out from under you, Jesus says, there's only one way to find peace. There's only one way to find stability, and that is through him. It's through Jesus. And we need to learn to hold loosely to all the things around us, and hold tightly to Christ. And unfortunately, what happens is too often we start to cling too tightly to the things that are around us, and we start to loosen our grip on Christ. And then we rely less and less on Christ, and more on those things. And then one day we find that those things start to crumble beneath us. And we wonder, what now? What do we do? Here's what we do. Back to these verses, verse 13. This will result. Now, this is when you're turned over, when your back is against the wall, when you're in prison, when somebody is coming against you. Then what? This will result in you being witnesses to them. Those who cling to Christ, those who have learned to live with a loose grip on the things of the world, and with a firm grip on Christ, simply stand as witnesses in whatever situation we are. It's not that we all of a sudden have to, okay, now I've got a witness. No. You are a witness. You are presently, you will be when you're in trouble. The question is, if you have learned to hold on tightly to Christ, your witness is one of Christ. And if you have not, your witness is one of clinging to other things. And when all of it gets taken away from you, if you have learned to cling to Christ, that will be evident to the people that are standing in front of you, even the people that are putting you in prison. Jesus goes on to say this. Verse 14, but make up your mind not to worry before. Make up your mind and say, if everything crumbles, I have not placed my confidence and trust in these sorts of things. I have placed my confidence in Christ, and I will not worry if things crumble. I may grieve, I may hurt, it may be painful, but I will not worry, I will not be afraid, because I have put my confidence in the Lord Jesus Christ. But make up your mind not to worry beforehand how you will defend yourselves, Jesus says. For I will give you words and wisdom that none of your adversaries will be able to resist or contradict. Do you realize that in order for Jesus to give us words and wisdom, he's actually already talking about the time he indwells his people?
That it's Christ who's forming us from the inside, that Christ who's gone from a man, a God, man who dies on a cross, who's buried, who was resurrected, and now who sits at the right hand of the Father, but who also indwells his people, that from that place of his indwelling spirit, Jesus Christ speaks when we allow him. And when we surrender our lives to Christ, and we continue to surrender our lives to Christ, we open our mouths and we allow Christ to fill us. And we decide, I'm not going to worry. I don't need a script. I simply need to trust Jesus. Are you in a place where when you open your mouth, you hear Jesus speaking? Have you found that there are situations and seasons where you're just simply trusting, Lord Jesus, would you give me the words to say these? I don't have words myself. And you find that actually what Jesus is saying, and this is a promise, and this is true, and this is what Jesus is saying for his people. When you do this, I will give you words and wisdom. It's a direct provision. It is a direct provision that Jesus offers to us. It's like when I was younger, my mom packed my lunch every day. And my lunchbox or my bag that I brought, I would open it up and I didn't inspect it before I went to school. Did mom put my lunch in there? Oh, it's just my mom did that. She just put my lunch in. So then when I got to the cafeteria, to the lunchroom, I would open it up and find whatever it was my mom put in there. Right? Depending on, it was different each day, put in there lunch. I just trusted. And the challenge is that some of us don't necessarily trust that Christ has put words in us. That when we open our mouth, he will speak for us. That we don't need to be afraid. That we don't need to try to come up with some script that we need. We simply trust him. Are you trusting? Do you see his provision? Or are you clinging too tightly? And see, my experience has been when I cling too tightly to something that is not Christ, it's really difficult to hear Christ, to see Christ, and to see his provision. Because I've trusted in my own stuff in trying to bring those things to bear, and there's not enough room for Christ to actually provide me with things that he is providing me with. So I find that actually I have to let go of those things and say, okay, Jesus, I'm really, really vulnerable right now. But will you fill my words? Will you fill my mouth with words? Will you fill my mind with the wisdom? And we allow me to act and respond as we will. Jesus says he will provide. He goes on in verse 18, but not a hair on your head will perish. By standing firm, you will gain life. There were times when Jesus' people actually died. They were led to the gallows. They were led to places. They were killed for their faith in Christ. What does this mean that not a hair on your head will perish? Well, for every time that happened, there's also times where people were actually released at the last moment. They were set free. They were let out of prison miraculously. And there are times when Jesus does that, and he miraculously sets us free from the bondage that we find ourselves in. And there's other times when actually he doesn't set us free, but he sets us free in death. Because the very Jesus that can set us free from prison or from difficulty in this life can also set us free in the life to come by resurrecting us and putting the very hairs back on our head that he promises will not perish. By standing firm, you will gain life. It's Ephesians 6, you can read that where it talks about the armor of God, and Jesus offers us the armor to stand against the things of Satan. Going on, verse 27, at that time they will see the Son of Man. So these are things that Jesus provides for us as individuals. He says, when you are put in prison, when you stand before people and you're asked to give account, that's for you. But now Jesus also says, there's something for the whole world here. And that is verse 27. At that time they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. When these things begin to take place, stand up and lift up your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. And when Jesus returns, he's setting everything right. And it doesn't matter whether you have trusted him or not. He is coming and he will set things right. And he will judge people based on what they have done with him. Have they accepted him? Have they received him? Have they lived their lives in faithfulness to the things that he has called them to? Or have they rejected him? And in that day,
everyone, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess, and everyone will see the great King, the great Judge, who comes to once finally fulfill His kingdom promises. That's for everyone, and that's something we need to keep in our minds as well, that Jesus is coming. Jesus sees it, and He's on His way. And again, there's a macro sense in which at the end of time, Jesus is going to return, and His kingdom will come to its fullness like we've never seen before. But there's a micro sense of this as well, that every action that we do, we find that Jesus is actually coming. And He's shaping, and He's changing, and He's doing things in the micro sense as well. And so are you watching for Him? Are you trusting Him to come? Come, Lord Jesus. Come into the situation. Come into this difficulty. Come into my situation that I'm struggling through. And after this, Jesus then talks about the fig trees and how you can see the buds and how you can see that the fullness is coming by just these little markers. And He goes on to say, be careful, in verse 34, or your hearts will be weighed down with dissipation, drunkenness, and the anxieties of life. Is your heart weighed down? Is your heart weighed down to such an extent that you turn to other things for fulfillment? Or perhaps not necessarily for fulfillment, to be able to cope with those anxieties? That you find actually you're in a place where you need help, and you cling to those things that you think are going to bring you help, but they actually bring you greater and greater hopelessness and greater darkness and greater despair. Jesus says, that's going to happen. That's going to happen. But what would He call us to? Not those things. He calls us, He says, the day will close on you unexpectedly like a trap, for it will come upon all those who live in the face of the whole earth. Be always on the watch and pray that you may be able to speak all that is about to happen, so that you may be able to stand before the Son of Man. And then the text goes on to talk about how Jesus made a routine of going out to the Mount of Olives and spending time in solitude. And let's turn now to chapter 22 and verse 39, where this is Jesus' usual routine, going out the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed Him. On reaching the place, He said to them, now this is Jesus' moment of deep anxiety. This is where Jesus is carrying the weight of the world, and He turns to His Father with that weight. And it's a model for us to say, when these anxieties come, when the world starts to crumble around you, when things are getting stripped away, and when you're tempted to fear, and you're tempted to turn, and you're not quite sure, am I being deceived, is this the truth, what am I supposed to do? And Jesus says, I will provide for you, and I'm coming. And then He says this, and I want you to do this, when you're filled with anxiety, I want you to pray. I want you to pray. Pray like Jesus. Are you praying? You spend time turning your anxiety over to Christ. You find yourself in those moments of deep anguish, wanting to pick up the phone and call someone or do something. You find yourself dropping to your knees in prayer, saying, Lord Jesus, would you come? Jesus says this to His disciples, pray that you will not fall into temptation. Jesus actually believes that His disciples can overcome the anxieties and the hopelessness and the helplessness by praying, by coming before the Father, and by just pouring their hearts out. Pray that you will not fall into temptation. He withdrew about a stone's throw beyond them and knelt down and he prayed, and He's now modeling for them. This is what you're called to do. Jesus is bearing the weight of the world. He's deeply, deeply troubled by what His Father is leading Him towards, and He needs help. You been there? You been in that place where you desperately need help? And He says this, Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. Lord, if you are willing, take this cup. But not my will, but yours be done. You see what Jesus does? He gets alone. He directs His prayer to the Father. He asks for help. When was the last time you came before the Father and said, Father, help me. We read about it in the Psalm. I need your help. I'm isolated. I'm alone. No one understands. I don't know what to do. Help me. The Father understands that. Christ Himself prayed that in the garden. He checks His intentions. Lord, not my will, but yours be done. And sometimes we find ourselves going down pathways of prayer, praying things that the Father is saying, I'm not going to answer that prayer. And we need to say, Lord, but not my will, not what I want. What is it that you want? What is it that you want, Father? And we listen to what the Father is asking of us, and we see it in his word time and time again. And the more anguish he experiences, because just because you drop your knees and start praying doesn't mean that all of a sudden, ooh, burdens are lifted, right? The more anguish he experiences, look at the text. An angel from heaven appeared and strengthened him, and being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly. The angel shows up to strengthen him, only to find that he's more deeply in anguish, and he prays more earnestly. Are you praying more and more earnestly as the darkness grows deeper and deeper? Do you find yourself coming before God and just pouring your heart? His sweat were like drops of blood. This is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. This is the Creator of the universe, who's now weighed down, recognizing his role of carrying the sin of the world, and he's in deep, deep anguish. And he's modeling for us. You've been in that kind of anguish? You felt the weight of the world in your shoulders? Now, recognizing you don't have the weight of the world on your shoulders, but have you been caught in situations where you just feel like, I am just so weighed down with sorrow? And you can choose the path of the disciples who spent time because they're so sorrowful they fell asleep. Or you can choose the path of Jesus who says, stand up and pray and drop to your knees and pray. And when you are in deeper anguish, pray all the more earnestly. And when he arose from prayer, he went back to the disciples and found them asleep, exhausted from sorrow. Jesus was exhausted from sorrow. They are exhausted from sorrow. Jesus turns to his Father in prayer. They fall asleep, and Jesus comes back to them and says, please pray so that you won't fall into temptation. I wonder how many of our battles are lost because we don't drop to our knees in prayer. I wonder how much we carry around because we're not praying. I wonder how often we're asleep at the wheel when Jesus says, would you just pray? And seek me, and I'm going to do something. And would you trust me? Don't carry that yourself. Don't fall asleep. Don't give in to the temptation to embrace hopelessness and darkness and despair. I am coming. And the power happens in the very next passage where we see Jesus acting with courage and clarity. And he even heals a man who came to arrest him. Why? Probably because Jesus spent time on his knees before his Father, and his Father was reminding him, Jesus, this is my plan. And I have called you to this, and I will never leave you or forsake you, and I will provide for you. And all those wonderful things that Jesus finishes telling us about in the previous chapter, and he's able to clearly step forward in his calling. And he's able to, with courage, stand against the people that were coming to arrest him. And he's able to heal the ear of a man who's ready to throw him in prison. That's the power that we see in prayer. So the Apostle Paul says, don't be anxious about anything. You feeling anxious? You feeling afraid? You feeling worried? You feeling the weight? Don't be anxious. In prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. Why? Because the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. And that comes when we pray, when we come before our God, and we seek Him in prayer. God's been laying that message not only on my heart, but he's been laying it on probably some of the others of you hearts. Brian Austin actually shared with me last week how God has been laying that word on his heart, a call to prayer. Brian, would you come? He's just going to share some words for us as a congregation that I think are timely and that are really important.
I'm not sure why, but this feels harder this service than it did the first service. You know, it's okay. There are times in my life when I sense God calling, and there's a sense of empowerment and triumph. There are times in my life when I sense God calling and I feel totally inadequate. This is one of those times. I have an urgency to call us as a church to prayer. Yet, prayer warrior feels like about as wrong a label as anyone could ever place on me. We have been hurting as a church. We've seen many people leave. I have recognized a grieving process in myself and in many of you. I know from personal experience that grief isn't something you just wake up one morning and find yourself done with. There have been multiple calls to prayer. I know that many of your small groups have been praying for our church. I know that many of you consistently pray in your private times for our church. I'm so thankful for that. But we've been trying to have a time of prayer in front of the sanctuary between services, probably for the last couple of months. It's maybe not the ideal time and place, and many of you have good reasons why you can't be there, at least not every week. But most weeks, there are only two or three of us. When one of those two or three is a guy like me, who sees his prayer life as one of his weakest areas, not one of his strengths, I'm increasingly afraid for this church, and I ache for this church. I'm asking you, I'm challenging you to join our little group to plead with God for healing. You may feel as inadequate as I feel, and that's okay. My Bible is full of counts of inadequate, fallible people and God doing great things through them. He is fully adequate, and it's Him I'm challenging to come before. One more thing I don't want to say, but need to. I suspect God is nudging at least a few of us, myself included, toward fasting as we pray for this church. I like my meals, so I don't like that nudging very much. Most fasts recorded in the Bible are very private between an individual and God, but a few, usually at critical times, are corporate. I wonder if this is a time when we as a church body should be considering a corporate fast. There's an Old Testament passage that haunts me every time I read it. It's Ezekiel 22:30. The context is Jerusalem, the city of God. It has become corrupt and full of sin. God is longing to heal, to redeem, to restore. He is searching for someone who will stand before him on behalf of the people of that city, someone who will plead for them. He finds no one. The passage, I looked for a man among them who would build up the wall and stand before me in the gap on behalf of the land, so I would not have to destroy it. But I found none. May it never, ever be said of Hanover Missionary Church that God searched for someone to stand in the gap, but found no one. I have felt so inadequate to make this call to prayer, but there's an urgency that won't let me rest until I obey. I am inadequate, but my God and your God is not. In my experience, though, many times he waits for our obedience before he acts. If this call is just for me, then it's totally appropriate for you to ignore it. But if you sense God speaking, however clumsy my words, then just obey him. So in coming weeks, between services, if you can come a few minutes early and join us up here at the front, that would be great. Don't do it for me. Do it for our church. Do it for God. I believe we're going to have a time of prayer right now as well. So thanks so much. And if you're coming early, want to grab a coffee and bring it up? I won't be offended, and I'm pretty sure God won't. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Brian. I appreciate that. Is the Lord speaking to you about a call to prayer, a call to fasting, perhaps? Perhaps you feel entirely inadequate. That's a perfect place to be. Maybe this morning you're feeling a little bit inadequate, and as Brian just referenced, a call to prayer, even now. So not to scare you, but I want to encourage you to just kind of maybe turn around to the 3, 4, maybe 5 people around you. And you don't have to be eloquent. In fact, the less eloquent you are, the better maybe it'll be. But just to be totally open with God and ask Him and cry out to Him for certain things. And so some things that I would suggest would be praying for the leadership of our congregation, praying for the search team of our congregation, praying for the next lead pastor, praying for compassion and care for one another. Perhaps the Lord will bring some things to mind for you. We're not going to take a lot of time here. We just want to begin, and we have lots of people here that no doubt are open to praying and to trusting God. So if you would, just take a bit of time, turn around. If you don't know the people around you, just introduce yourself. If you don't feel comfortable praying, you can just sit in silence, and that's okay to pray silently. I still remember the first time when I prayed publicly, and I was absolutely terrified, but actually it was a beautiful experience. People were accepting around me, and no doubt you'll find the same around you, that people will be warmly accepting of whatever words that you utter. And so we trust that Christ will take our prayers and use them and shape them and change our hearts and change things actually in the heavenly realms. We're trusting and believing that He's actually doing that as we come before Him in prayer. So let's take some time. I'll come and close, but take as much time as you want. And if you want to stick around and even have some quiet time after the service is over, that's entirely okay. So take some time, introduce yourself to the people around you, and focus some time in prayer now.